There was a time when the ring of the anvil was a familiar sound in every town and village. But that was a long time ago. So long, in fact, that some might think the blacksmith's craft is one of the lost arts and belongs to the days of our grandfathers. Actually, this is far from true. Although the art of forging is as old as history itself, its practices have been transformed to fit our modern needs. Today's forge is a modern oil or gas-burning furnace where billets of special quality steel are brought to forging heat. The blacksmith's hammer has grown to a powerful machine that multiplies the strength of his muscles a thousandfold. His crude anvil now appears as a carefully made die that shapes the hot metal with swift precision. Thus, the skill of the smith, as important now as it ever was, has been aided and abetted by many other skills, so that now we can forge the metal faster, reproduce the desired contours exactly, and as many times as may be needed. A fundamental fact about forging is the quality improvement that hot working imparts to the metal. This is a natural consequence of the forging process itself, which allows the original grain flow of the metal to conform to the contours of the finished piece. It works in our favor equally well whether the forging blow is struck by the hand hammer of the blacksmith or a 1,000-pound bored drop hammer or a 50,000-pound steam-driven giant. But huge forgings like this are the exception, not the rule. To learn what forgings really mean to us in our daily lives, let's take an example we all know about. For instance, the family car. It's a convenience we all take for granted, and one we'd have a tough time getting along without. It takes a lot of forgings to build a car. Normally, of course, they're concealed beneath a handsome exterior. But if we just dissolve that exterior away, leaving only the vital chassis, then we can take a really good look at its works. Let's start with the engine, whose component parts are made of many materials and by many processes. Cylinder block and manifolds are cast iron. In the distributor, we find a shaft that is machined to size and shape from solid bar stock. Fan blades are stamped from sheet steel, and so are cylinder head covers. Valve rocker arms are steel forgings, and so are many of the vital parts that transmit the engine's power. Connecting rods, crankshaft, and transmission gears, universal yokes and crosses, and differential gears and pinions. And in the chassis, the steering knuckle, arm, and kingpins are all forgings. Our car is thus a beautifully integrated whole, built up from many kinds of parts, each suited to its particular kind of service. Where maximum strength and toughness are essential, these parts are forgings, because forging develops the utmost quality in the metal through refining and controlling its grain structure. A connecting rod is a first-class example of this. Here is the die in which the rod is made. Its two matching halves contain the impressions that correspond to the shape of the rod. In use, the dies are mounted in a drop forging hammer, the lower half fixed, while the upper half is fastened to the ram, which can fall freely to bring the two matching halves together. The connecting rod starts as a steel blank of the proper size, called in the trade a multiple, which is heated in the furnace until the steel becomes somewhat plastic and will flow under the blows of the hammer. Here's what the rod looks like after trimming and cleaning. This one has been cut in two and the exposed surface polished, then etched with acid. This reveals how the grain structure conforms to the shape of the piece, concentrating the grain density and fiber formation at the points of greatest stress. Most forgings are made in drop hammers. One widely used type is the board drop hammer. It gets its name from the hard maple boards that are attached to the ram. At the top of the frame, they pass between, but do not quite touch continuously running rollers. Whenever the ram has fallen to deliver, the rollers automatically press against the boards and drive them upward, carrying the ram up to its top position. Then the boards are caught and held by wedge action until the hammerman releases them for the next blow. This cycle will repeat itself automatically as long as the treadle is held down. This hammer is rated at 2,500 pounds, that being the weight of the ram. Board hammers run up to about 7,500 pounds and make forgings up to about 30 pounds. Another kind of gravity drop hammer is the airlift hammer. Instead of boards to raise the ram, an air cylinder and piston do the work. Operating the treadle lets the ram fall freely of its own weight. An important feature of the airlift is that the hammerman can control the length of stroke, varying the blow from light to heavy. This is a steam drop hammer. They are usually built bigger and heavier than gravity hammers, run in falling weight up to 50,000 pounds, and use a double-acting steam cylinder to raise the ram and to drive it downward so that the force of the blow is greatly increased. The ram is automatically kept moving up and down between working strokes in order to prevent condensation of steam in the cylinder and valves. By varying the steam pressure, the hammerman can deliver a light or heavy blow as required. The hot steel multiple usually has some surface scale as a result of heating, and this is removed by an air jet or steam nozzle. Steam hammers using closed dies produce drop forgings weighing up to several tons. You have probably noticed how the hammerman uses different cavities in the die as the work progresses. The most important reason for this is that full development of proper grain flow in the metal requires progressive forging steps. To show how this works out, here's a typical die. It's two halves laid out so we can study these steps. And here we have a number of partly finished forgings to show what each step does. This is the fullering impression and is the first one used. Holding the multiple in this position reduces the section of the metal for the shank of the rod. The edging impression is next. It is used to gather the stock where it will be needed for the larger sections, such as the big boss on the crank end. In blocking, the next step, several blows form the hot metal into approximately its final shape. The final operation is done in the finishing impression. Now all details of the final shape appear, the maximum improvement in the quality of the metal has been achieved, and the piece is ready for trimming. Here is a set of trimmer dies consisting of the die and the punch. When set up in a press, it will shear the flash off cleanly, leaving a finished forging of the exact shape required, needing only a bare minimum of machining before assembly. Some forgings are made in another type of equipment called a forging machine or upsetter, of which this is an example. In upset forging, the hot metal is worked not by hammer blows, but by applying squeeze pressure to the heated portion of a bar of stock, displacing the metal and forcing it to fill a cavity in the die. The die itself is made in two halves, which open to admit the stock and close to grip it tightly on each work stroke of the machine. The finished forging appears on the end of the bar of stock and needs only to be cut off, a job usually done with speed and accuracy by a fast-cutting hot saw. Looking down into the machine from above, we can see that the actual displacing of the metal is done by a ram or header that moves into the die cavity on each work stroke. These wooden models show how the header operates, moving into the cavity from the rear of the machine. This is called a three-pass die, with three cavities and three headers, corresponding to three progressive stages in forming the metal to its final shape. The first two headers are hollow. Removing a portion of one will let us see just how it works. The blank is merely a bar of forging steel heated to working temperature. It is inserted in the die cavity, which then closes around it, gripping the bar tightly at this point. Now let's look inside the die and see what happens when the heading tool is brought into position. Pressing on the end of the bar with great force, it shortens and expands it to fill the hollow in the header, then withdraws. Now the piece is transferred to the second cavity and the ram moves in again. This further shortens and expands the piece. Now it is ready for the finishing cavity or the final pass. This time the header, a solid bar, expands the stock to the full diameter of the finishing cavity. When it withdraws, the completed forging may be removed from the die. To make larger or more complex parts, dies with more cavities and headers are used. This one, with four passes, produced this forge blank for a gear shift countershaft. This gear cluster forging was made in a similar set of dies. Cutting it at two and etching with acid shows the control of grain structure and fiber formation achieved by upset forging, which results in a finished part of maximum strength and durability. Another means of forging by the use of squeeze pressure is the mechanical press. Presses like this are capable of exerting up to several thousand tons of pressure on the hot metal. This press is making shell casing bases. The simple round shape is very well adapted to high-speed press production. Only one die cavity is needed for this forging, although two strokes of the press are required. The first one upsets the metal blank, breaks the scale, and partly positions the grain flow. On the second stroke, the upset blank is forced into the die impression, which gives it its final form and finish. For large forgings of aluminum or magnesium, a hydraulic press is often used. This one is capable of exerting 18,000 tons of pressure, and even larger ones are being built. Here we see aluminum alloy being worked into an impeller wheel for a jet engine. Right now, a billet of the alloy, heated to forging temperature, is being pre-worked between flat dies to improve its grain structure. Next comes the first pressing or blocking that brings the billet roughly to shape. Then, in a second die, the finishing strokes give the forging its final form. As in any other kind of closed die forging, the hot plastic metal is forced to flow step by step into the contours of the finished piece, with its grain structure developed and improved at each step. In addition to hammers and presses, auxiliary forging equipment is often used. For example, forging rolls reduce a short, thick section to a long, thin one, or modify the cross-section of the stock prior to forging. In this case, partly finished forgings are being elongated and tapered to make tractor gear shift levers. Some preparatory forging is done with plain flat dies. The method is called Smith forging and is here being used to make a tongue hold on this billet to prepare it for a closed die hammer. This is a trip hammer or helve hammer, another type of auxiliary equipment. A typical use is drawing out and tapering large stock preparatory to finish forging in a closed die, thus making for a simpler die in the drop hammer. This, like all other auxiliary equipment, is one more means of utilizing closed dies to the best advantage. Because it's the closed die and all the technology that goes with it that combines the benefits of mass production with the fine quality of forged metal. So the die itself is the focal point of the whole process, and the making of the dies a vital part of any forging plant. Die blocks are made from special alloy steel, forged to the dimensions needed for each die to be made, and heat-treated to assure maximum hardness and die wear. The first step is to drill holes in each block into which handling bars may be inserted for easy manipulation of the heavy block while in work. A planing operation machines the shanks that will attach the dies to the ram and the anvil of the drop hammer. The next step is to plane two edges of each block at exact right angles to each other. The die maker will use these matched edges as baselines in laying out the die impressions. The face of each die block is dressed in a surface grinder. This will result in a smooth, accurate surface upon which to do the layout work. Now the die maker has begun the layout work, the outlining of the die impression on the face of the block. When this is completed, the impressions are sunk into the die, beginning with the finishing impression that gives the forging its final size and shape. It is located near the center of the die, so the weight of the falling ram will be centered on the forging. While the block is still in the machine, the other impressions are also roughed out, subject to final corrections that may be needed later on. After machining the impressions, there is always some handwork to do: scraping, filing, grinding, and polishing the cavities. When this has been completed, the two halves are clamped together and a proof of the finishing impression made by filling it with molten lead or dye compound. This proof will be carefully checked for accuracy and sent to the customer for approval. If all is well, the other impressions can then be completed and the finishing impression surrounded by a gutter, a shallow depression for receiving the flash or slight excess of metal squeezed out by the finishing blows of the hammer. The completed dies are finally ready for careful inspection to make certain that all dimensions are correct and that finish is up to standards. Equally important, the edging, fullering, and blocking impressions are studied to make sure they are properly shaped to direct the grain structure of the metal to best advantage step by step as the forging progresses. Every forging die needs a corresponding trimmer die, and the work is generally planned so they're both ready at the same time. Since this is to be a hot trimmed job, the die maker is using the same lead cast that was made as a proof of the forging die to check the contour of the trimmer die. When the completed forging dies are finally installed in the hammer and lined up carefully for exact registration of the two halves, then the painstaking work that went into the planning, making, and checking of the dies gives assurance that they'll do their work perfectly from the first forging on. In the normal process of drop forging, the steel receives a certain amount of beneficial hot working, and in some cases may need no subsequent heat treatment. But in most cases, like these gas engine crankshafts, forgings was specified because the part had to have maximum strength and toughness. Heat treating is needed to develop these qualities to the fullest possible extent. This is a typical modern continuous type heat treating setup. The forgings first enter the hardening furnace, where they can be brought to any specified temperature from 1400 to 1900 degrees Fahrenheit. As they fall from the belt at the end of the furnace, they drop into the quenching bath below. This can be whatever water or oil bath is required to obtain the desired properties. The conveyor takes the hardened forgings up and across to the tempering furnace, where the slow process of drawing is accomplished. This is by no means the only method of heat treating forgings. There are many others, just as there are thousands of kinds of forgings, each needing the special treatment required to suit it for its job. After forging and heat treating, there is still a thin layer of iron oxide or scale on the surface of the steel. This can be removed by mechanical or chemical means. The chemical method is called pickling and consists of dipping the forgings in an appropriate solution long enough to loosen and remove all scale, then rinsing them in neutralizing solutions and water. One mechanical method is by blasting the forgings, usually with metallic shot. The forgings are loaded into the cleaning chamber and bombarded with steel shot until all traces of scale are removed. One reason that scale removal is important is that machining and finishing time and tool wear are greatly reduced when the metal surface is clean and free from scale. So far, we've given much attention to the process of forging and very little to the material. Actually, one is just as important as the other. Maximum strength can be developed only if the metal has the proper qualities to begin with. And each forging to be made calls for a steel with properties best suited to do its job. To make the enormous number of forgings in use today requires a vast variety of high-grade steels. Each different alloy, designated by color code and SAE alloy number, has been specified to meet the requirements of a particular forging application. To make certain the requirements will be met, samples of every lot are marked out for analysis by the Forging Quality Control Laboratory. Careful chemical analysis double-checks the composition of the alloy. Physical properties are determined by hardenability and other mechanical tests. Microscopic analysis will reveal grain size and crystalline structure, which have a lot to do with the behavior of the steel. If a particular lot of steel gets the nod from the metallurgist, it is okay to cut up into multiples according to the size and weight of the forging to be made. This is done by shearing the bars, either hot or cold, or sawing them when the bars are too big to shear or when squared ends are needed. Forging multiples cover a tremendous range in size and weight. This little blank weighs about an ounce and will be forged into a carburetor link that weighs even less. On the other hand, this massive multiple, weighing well over a ton and requiring a crane to handle it, will be hammered into a landing gear, cylinder, and strut for a big airplane. Nothing could be simpler in form than the multiples from which forgings are made. Yet from these elementary shapes, a few swift blows of the hammer can produce an almost infinite variety of useful forms, each with all the strength, toughness, and durability that is inherent in the process of forging hot steel. Over 600,000 different forgings are being made today, and the number is constantly growing. Let's have a look at how some of the more interesting of these are made. An automobile crankshaft is certainly interesting enough to start with. Here's the finished crankshaft forging alongside the billet from which it was made. This is a crankshaft forging unit consisting of two steam hammers and their auxiliary equipment. The hammer nearest us is the first one used and does the preliminary forging. Its die carries the rolling impression and the first and second blocking impressions. In the second hammer, the die has only one impression. Thus, the power of the hammer is concentrated on the forging during the finishing blows. The trimmer press is located near the finishing hammer, and the crankshaft is trimmed hot. The flash remains on top of the die while the forging falls through. Tools for the dentist and surgeon are a far cry from the heavy crankshaft, but the inherent strength and toughness of forged steel are as important to one as to the other. These forceps are made from two similar forgings assembled together. They start as a bar of special alloy of stainless steel, and in a very short space of time, the hammer has forged another pair of forceps. Small parts can often be produced economically by forging more than one from the same multiple. This die has three identical cavities and makes three parts at once from each bar of stock. The group of forgings, together with their common flash, is called a platter. One stroke of the trimmer punch suffices to free all the forgings from the flash at once. Now let's look in on a really heavy forging job. This billet of special alloy steel is about to be forged into a part of a catapult for launching jet planes from an aircraft carrier. This is, or will be, a sizable forging weighing some 1,300 pounds. Its unusual shape calls for a die with a cavity 12 feet long. The top half of the die weighs 14 tons. The ram weighs 20. A total of 68,000 pounds of falling weight with the added force of a full head of steam behind it. That will give you some idea of the size range of forgings. But even in a whopper like this one, the same principles of development of proper grain flow, of improving the metal quality, still hold. Sometimes welding is called upon to combine two or more forgings into one in cases where the desired part is too big or too awkwardly shaped to forge in one piece, yet must have the strength and quality of a forging. This crew has just finished welding three large forgings together to form the main landing gear strut for a large transport plane. One of the most interesting and spectacular uses of forgings is in the modern turbojet airplane engine. Here's how such an engine begins. This block of steel is about to be forged into one of the compressor wheels. The stainless steel alloy used is very tough and resistant to deformation, even when hot, and calls for one of the biggest of the steam hammers. After being finished forged in another hammer, this is what the wheel forging looks like. Here the blades for the engine are being finished forged. This is one of the forged blades after trimming. Here's how it looks after the finishing work is done. And here's how it fits into the wheel. Of course, there's a great deal more than forgings in a turbojet engine. But just as we have found in other fields, where conditions are most severe, where stresses are the highest, where human life depends on reliability, there you're most likely to find forgings in use. As the pilot starts his engine, runs it up and takes off, the sound and fury of the jets can speak louder than any words for the ability of forgings to do the tough jobs well, and for the contribution they make, not only to our standards of living, but to our very safety as a nation. Since the dawn of civilization, man's history has been tied to his use of metal. The progress of today's world relies more and more upon metal products formed or molded into every conceivable shape. With the advent of the space age, the contribution of so-called sophisticated metals has opened the door to a new horizon of technology. There are many methods of shaping metal products. This film tells the story of open die forging. Open die, or free-form forgings, are made on hammers or presses employing dies that are smoothly shaped but not completely restricting metal flow, taking advantage of the plasticity of metal at forging temperatures. Forging is undoubtedly the oldest mechanical forming method in the metalworking art and has its roots in the traditional blacksmith operation. Longfellow wrote, "Beneath the spreading chestnut tree, the village smithy stands. The smith, a mighty man is he, with large and sinewy hands." Early American history is a reminder of the important role hand forging played in the nation's growth. In due course, the blacksmith was aided by power developments beyond his own physical capacity. Today, huge manipulators, mechanical devices for handling ingots during forging, do the work of the blacksmith's hands and arms. Modern hammers or presses exerting millions of pounds of force replace the blacksmith's hammer.
Infernos of heat take the place of the blacksmith's hearth and bellows. And today, a wide range of sophisticated alloys are formulated to specific properties to match the end product requirements of the customer. Iron and steel, it is said, are close to being immortal. After careful classification, scrap is used over and over again. The sound of the word scrap contradicts the sophisticated technology involved in its use. The process begins with samples undergoing laboratory analysis and classification before melting and subsequent reprocessing. This analysis is repeated throughout the melting cycle to make sure the heat of steel contains the right amount of each element specified. Alloy additions are made to the molten bath as a result of these laboratory tests. Today's needs for super steels has produced constantly expanding demands for technicians in metallurgy. In addition to college-trained technicians, laboratories of the forging industry offer to high school graduates the opportunity of entering the metallurgy field. Many companies sponsor in-plant and advanced formal training programs. The highest purity metal for forgings can be produced by electric arc or vacuum furnaces, and subsequent vacuum degassing, vacuum arc remelt, or electroslag remelt. The liquid metal is tapped into a large refractory lined ladle and moved by powerful electrically driven overhead cranes from the electric arc furnace to the vacuum degassing chamber. Refining steel in a vacuum helps to rid it of certain deleterious gases, such as hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. The reduction of these gases makes it possible for the forger to meet the more rigid customer requirements of jet engines, die steels, high-speed rotating equipment, and nuclear applications. Inside the vacuum chamber, the steel boils very much like candy fudge. Throughout every phase of steelmaking, tests and samples are continually examined to ensure customer satisfaction. The material required in forging may range in size from small billets or flumes of a few pounds to huge ingots weighing several hundred thousand pounds or more. The steel industry has contributed to the success of the open die forger by working in close harmony to supply specified raw materials. Modern metallurgical research and quality control laboratories throughout the forging industry daily search for still better utilization of the potentials of metal. Forging enhances all of the basic mechanical characteristics of metals, such as ductility and tensile strength. Here, a machine piece under production is tested for these properties by measuring precisely the amount of tension it will withstand before rupturing. Maximum ductility is forged into metals to be used in such high-stress application as helicopter parts. Another characteristic of forged metal is its ability to absorb impact. This test measures the amount of energy absorbed in fracturing a prepared sample. Here, the impact is shown in stop-motion photography. High impact absorption qualities are required in applications where repeated shock is encountered. This Rockwell test measures the hardness of the forged product. The indentation size is used to determine material hardness. Particularly hard and tough metals are called for in many applications in mineral handling, steel production, and fabrication. All these properties of metal are improved in forged products by refining grain structure. Forging is, in reality, the improving or refining of grain structure. But modern forging is more than technology alone. To the sounds of hammers and presses, the forming of shapes is a symphony of color. The modern forging plant stocks or melts a wide variety of popular grade carbon, alloy, stainless, tool steels, low alloy, and special super alloys. As a result, forged products can be produced to almost any metallurgical specification more rapidly than cast or fabricated parts. Emergency requirements can often be satisfied in a few days. Typical parts produced from an inventory like this are high-quality forged rings. A solid steel block of exact weight for making the ring to be forged is cut and then heated to forging temperature. When the metal block has been flattened and rounded, a slug is punched from the center. At this stage of shaping, the ring is colorfully known as a donut. Manufacturers forge rings measuring in diameter from inches to many feet. The forging process produces a solid ring with unbroken flow lines. This smooth grain flow adds strength and toughness superior to that of cast or welded rings. As in most forging operations, this process of pre-forming the hot metal to desired shape is accomplished in a series of heating and forging operations. Rings are used extensively in anti-friction bearings, in rocket and jet engines, in gears, tires, and turbines, in missiles, and in many other applications that require high-quality circular shapes. For larger rings, the prepared donut is rolled on one or more ring rollers depending upon final dimensions required. As the ring revolves between the main roll and the pressure roll, its diameter grows as the edging rolls control its width. Typical of the application of modern technology to the forging industry is this ring expander as a final sizing operation. With this automatic equipment, exact dimensions greatly reduce the amount of final machining. Most forgings are given some form of heat treating before shipment. The particular process is chosen to produce the necessary mechanical properties and to assure satisfactory service performance. One form of heat treatment, called annealing, is specified when the product must be relatively soft for machining. In this case, a large weldless steel ring is being machined for a solid propellant booster to precision tolerances. Basic ring forgings may be cut to various shapes or supplied as blanks to the gear cutting industry. They may support thousands of tons in manufacturing processes or become the dies used in pipe rolling or other fabrication equipment. Throughout the petroleum and chemical industry, many high-pressure pipe couplings are ring-forged. And the stresses of modern jet engines demand the quality of many forged components. Multiple diameter or hub forgings can be quickly supplied from stock dies, providing forged quality and close tolerances economically. Another basic forging operation used to produce circular hollow parts similar to rings, but up to many feet in length, is known as hollow forging. A hole is pierced through the center of a prepared billet with a series of punches. The mandrel, a bar that is inserted into the cavity of a prepared block, is used in conjunction with a press to expand and lengthen the forging wall. This forging, a liner for the extrusion industry, is produced from extremely hard tool steel. To aid in rough machining, it is annealed or softened by a hot salt bath. Liners like this one, being precision bored, are used in extruding a wide range of rod or tubular material, including brass, copper, aluminum, and plastics. This large liner will be used to produce copper alloy rod, extruded under extreme pressures of over 11 million pounds. A wide range of other products, ranging in size from 1 to many feet, are mandrel forged. Included are large gun tubes, chemical retorts, reactor chambers, pressure vessels, rings, and gear tires. The diameter and length of mandrel forgings are practically unlimited. Roll sleeves like this are precision machined and used in a wide variety of manufacturing rolling processes. By using a sleeve over the exterior surface that is subjected to wear, only the sleeve section needs to be periodically replaced. This mandrel forged sleeve has been heated to the precise temperature which produces sufficient expansion to allow fitting over the roll surface. When the sleeve has been placed over the roll and cools, contraction holds it in place. To remove a worn sleeve, the process is reversed. This exacting process, known as shrinking on sleeves, is another outstanding contribution of the open die forging industry. Sleeve and roll combinations are machined to whatever finish is required. They are used extensively in rolling steel, forming metals, as well as in the linoleum, plastics, rubber, and other industries. Hollow forging was called upon to provide the optimum strength characteristics of today's super steels, used in missile cylinders and many other smaller components. Many forgings are part of the Navy nuclear program. Special applications have included radio telescope access gear. And hollow forgings are widely used in a host of high-pressure applications, including chemical retorts and reaction chambers. A wide range of special products having the toughness and durability required in their application are forged on relatively small hammers. The craftsmanship of these specialists is developed over many years, and the growing need for their skills offers the opportunity for young men to enter one of the highest paid crafts. Crane hooks are subjected to intense operational stress and must provide maximum strength, toughness, and resistance to fatigue in those areas subjected to the greatest shock and stress. This hot bending operation under the hammer achieves the necessary optimum grain flow. Even in complex shapes, forgings can be produced to extremely close tolerances, thereby frequently reducing to a surprising degree the need for machining. Although rough or semi-finished forgings are regularly ordered, most manufacturers combine machining and finishing facilities with forging and heat treating to provide a complete service. The crane hook, a familiar item, is manufactured by the open die forging method. It is representative of thousands of specialty items essential in the operation of practically every industry that must be preformed by this forging method. Specialty forgings can be complicated in shape or be plain flats for knives on severe applications, or the jaws for powerful bending or shearing presses. Slabs or plate sections like these, heavier or thicker than can be produced by rolling operations on a slabbing mill, become heavy plate sections for fabricated parts or dies for the closed die forging, plastic, and die cast industries. As with other forgings, they are finished to required size and shape by the machine shops of the forging company. The largest forgings are usually forged directly from ingots that are never allowed to cool until the forging is finished. For the heavier forgings, powerful hydraulic presses are used, in which the heated metal is squeezed into the desired shape. This process, called upsetting, shortens the ingot axis while increasing its cross-section and at the same time compacting the center. This configuration would be necessary in such products as discs, heavy sections for rotor and generator forgings, stub ends, and gear blanks. During forging, the manipulator operator controls the movement of the ingot, often weighing many tons, with as much precision and dexterity as the early day blacksmith handled a horseshoe with his tongs. Forging shafts employs the method known as drawing out or forging solid. This method will produce a forging whose length is considerably greater than its diameter, by reducing the cross-section and simultaneously elongating the ingot or bloom. Here, swage or semi-rounded dies are used to produce a more perfectly rounded forging. These typical forgings may become pinions, dies, machine tool parts, or satisfy a variety of other high-stress requirements. The open-die forge shops producing today's largest forgings have continued to increase the capacity of their equipment to match the demands of today's technology. Presses with capacities up to 14,000 tons are in operation to handle giant forgings. Ingots weighing nearly 800,000 pounds have been cast for heavy industry applications. Electrical equipment manufacturers are major users of shaft forgings in massive rotors for generating equipment, as well as large electric motors wherever ultimate reliability is essential. Other applications include ship shafts or propulsion drives of large ocean vessels, massive multi-throw crankshafts, and huge rolls used throughout the metal forming industry, as well as a wide cross-section of manufacturing processes. The heat treating process further refines the grain structure, removes residual stresses, develops the strength and ductility of the steel to make a good forging a better one. Where unusual characteristics are demanded, special heat treating processes are available. This vertical quench assures straightness and product uniformity. Shafts, like other forgings, are brought to their finished or semi-finished stage on the many turning and boring lathes, planers, milling machines, slotters, grinders, and vertical boring mills. And as modern technology creates new demands, forging capacities and capabilities have kept pace. Never before have the opportunities for high school and college graduates been greater. With an eye toward the future, the open-die forging industry has developed extensive apprentice, on-the-job, and technical training programs. College graduates find increasing opportunities and challenging careers throughout the industry in such areas as computers, production control, accounting, engineering, melting and forge plant operations, metallurgy, and management. Participating in such a basic industry, which supplies practically all other industries with forged steel products, provides the individual with occupational activity which he will find exciting, challenging, and financially rewarding. Typical of the ever-expanding technical advances in the forging industry is this spray quench heat treating process. This large roll, for a steel rolling mill, is being surface hardened to desired characteristics and hardness profile. Finished rolls, as with all forgings, are subjected to a series of quality control tests. This sclerescope hardness test assures that the surface of these rolls meets required specifications. But the area below the exterior surface also undergoes quality tests. Ultrasonic test equipment assures consistent metal composition and freedom from internal flaws. Wherever industry demands ultimate quality, such programs of quality control assure that open die forgings represent the highest standard of reliability. Rolls for the metal forming industry in hundreds of applications and sizes are a major contribution of the forging industry. And when an electrical generator surges into operation, its massive rotors, produced by open die forging, withstand the stresses of peripheral speeds equal to modern jet aircraft. And like the electricity that flows out across miles of power lines, so free-form forgings flow into almost every aspect of our everyday life. Another industry relying upon forged products is railroad transportation. The forging of train, subway, and other axles capitalizes upon the efficiency of automation and computer control. Quality forged into this metal will assure its dependability as it operates in yet another industry that relies upon the open die forger. Crankshafts for large diesels and other engines are produced from forgings to assure ideal grain and stress characteristics. As technology strained the limitations of exotic metals to the ultimate in nuclear applications, forgings were essential. From the special metals, alloys, and forging procedures developed, a wide range of other industries now benefit. Forgings were silent partners in many applications that protected man in his venture into space. And as tomorrow's world is forged, the products that shape our world will rely upon the contributions of open die forging for ultimate quality in metal fabrication. The strongest metal product is a forging.
And his rate of progress is determined not only by his qualities as a craftsman, but also by the qualities of the tools at his command. And so, impelled by the endless hope that his works may excel and endure, man's quest on earth has always been for ever more reliable and durable tools to match his persistent and growing ambition to produce excellent results. Anything can be a tool, a wheel, shaft, or shoe, a ring, gear, or fork. Man through the ages has turned for his most critically important tools toward what is both the oldest known and among the most modern and advanced of all metal forming methods. The process known as forging. To forge is to hammer or to squeeze a metal progressively into a prescribed shape. This movement of the metal in a prescribed manner refines and elongates the grain of the metal, producing maximum strength and fatigue resistance for that material. Whatever the part, it is given greatest strength at points of greatest stress by controlling grain flow in developing the forging. The result is a part with unexcelled strength-to-weight ratio. As the internal structure of the piece is refined and oriented, the shape is being produced. And as the shape is produced, added strength, structural integrity, impact, and fatigue resistance, and other improved mechanical properties are developed. Forging and the heat treatment which may follow it enable the fullest capabilities of a material to be realized. A properly designed forging provides maximum structural integrity, reliability, and durability by virtue of the unique working it has received. Almost any metal can be forged. It usually starts with billets and bars, but sometimes starts with ingots or metal powder and proceeds in a variety of ways to produce the necessary metal movement. Forging is accomplished by forcing the material into the confines of the carefully designed die cavity. Some forgings are hammered, and some are squeezed. The main difference between hammering and squeezing is the speed with which the pressure is applied. There are materials which are forged best by sharp hammer-like blows, and other materials which resist rapid reshaping and must be forged with slowly applied force. Many parts can be produced either way, at the option of the forging designer, who also has at his disposal several supplementary means of forging, which provide him with ways of achieving desired shapes and configurations. For example, shaping metal between rolls may be a forging operation. So is twisting. And so is bending. Used before or after basic forging operations, such supplemental means make it possible to forge more complex configurations. There are three general types of closed die forging designs, distinguished mainly by their degree of dimensional sophistication, as illustrated by these three versions of a typical channel section. These are no draft, commercial, and blocker type forging designs. Most sophisticated of forgings is the no draft or close tolerance type, which is closest to a fully completed part, needing little or no machining to make it ready for assembly. Next are those forgings whose configurations are less sophisticated, generally calling for some subsequent machining to make them functional. Commonest of forgings, they are called commercial designs. Commercial type forgings have slightly tapered rather than vertical sidewalls. This is only enough to free the finished piece from the dies, and the angle usually ranges from 3 to 7 degrees. Some surfaces of many commercial forgings are ultimately used as forged. Some commercial forgings are further refined by coining, which brings the forging closer to the dimensions of the ultimate part. The least precise of closed die forgings are the blocker type designs. Blocker type designs are used when the characteristics of forgings are wanted in the finished parts, but time does not permit or the quantity does not warrant the sinking of more complex dies. As their name implies, they are blocked out shapes which roughly approximate the form of the ultimate part. No draft. Commercial. And blocker type. These are the distinctive types of closed die forging designs. Another distinct type of forging is the open die or flat die forging, which uses the simplest dies and produces the least precise configuration. For For some applications, it meets a real need. The successive steps required to produce a forging may be performed in various ways, depending upon the requirements of the finished part. Here are some examples of forging production. A board hammer, steam hammer, airlift hammer, mechanical press, horizontal forging machine or upsetter, hydraulic press, high energy rate machine, an impactor, heat treatment when required to complete the development of optimum properties is frequently provided by the forging's producer, who is also equipped to clean the parts. The closed die forging process assures a high degree of structural integrity and dimensional uniformity, part after part, and offers assurance that inspection requirements can be minimized. The internal uniformity of forgings provides consistent machinability and lends itself to consistently trouble-free, high-speed processing. To help a designer determine when a forging should be used, he can review some of the uses to which forgings are already being put and why. For example, forgings are found at vital points of automobiles, they provide safety in a high-speed world, also on bulldozers, earth-moving equipment, on hard-working equipment like this hydraulic hammer, and forklifts. Forgings fill critical requirements in railway applications, mining equipment, trench diggers, valve and pressure fittings, tractors, trucks, aircraft, and missiles. A product designer seeking maximum engineering value in designing a part which is relatively lighter in weight, less bulky, stronger, more shock and fatigue resistant, more easily machined and heat treated, weldable, and economical, can make no better move than to call in a qualified forging engineer. The help of experts with broad forging experience is essential, because forging is a fine blend of art and science, and both theory and practice are required for maximum effectiveness. They will consider the functional requirements for the part, including stresses and operating environment. The overall assembly, perhaps thinking of possible economies of integrating two or more parts into a single forging. How many of these parts will be needed? How soon and over what period of time? They will consider the fillet and corner radii and the thickness, depth, and draft angles of webs, ribs, or flanges. Going too far one way can make a forging needlessly expensive to produce. Going too far the other way can make it bulkier and heavier than it needs to be. They will consider the properties the part must have to determine the proper forging and heat treatment operations. The corrosion problems the part may experience. Its operating temperatures and the temperature changes it must undergo. The selection of the metal or alloy. The machining methods and locating points. They will have in mind greater economy coupled with greater reliability and effectiveness. Excellence of design, appropriateness of material, and the fullest possible use of the characteristics forging can bring to any assembly. The art of forging is being augmented by the science of forging at an increasingly rapid rate, especially in the fields of research, development, and quality control. Better forging materials and new ways of forging for optimum properties and soundness are being developed by comprehensive programs. The advance is continual, using a variety of techniques. Improved types of corrosion, impact, and magnetic permeability tests. Ultrasonic, radiographic, and dye-penetrant inspection methods. Electron microscopy. Spectrographic analysis. The complete range of modern laboratory instrumentation. Forging capabilities and knowledge have expanded immensely in recent years, and this learning is being advanced at an accelerating rate. Steady advance in forging technology continually transforms difficult designs into practical production. The vision and the courage to go ahead are the only observable limitations on the growth, refinement, and enlargement of the forging process. There was a time, for example, when the only way to transfer a forging from one operation to another was by hand. Today, this is done mechanically, when the quantities involved make it economically feasible, or when the weight involved makes it humanly desirable. There was a time not long ago when forgings this large could not be made because there was no equipment large enough to forge them. There was a time when a configuration like this was considered difficult to forge because the metal would cool too rapidly for it to be forced through such thin webs and fill the rim. Today, such configurations are increasingly available. There was a time when copper and its alloys, and later carbon and low alloy steels, were about the only metals considered forgeable. Today, the list of metals forged is long and growing continuously, including a large number of steel alloys and the MAR-aging steels, along with aluminum, magnesium, titanium, tungsten, beryllium, columbium, molybdenum, zirconium, hafnium, and others. Carbon and low alloy steels have long been the workhorse materials for forgings, and they meet a variety of service requirements. These are the forgings that have helped to empower humanity to farm its crops, to manufacture its products, to build its highways, and to put people and their goods on wheels. The carbon and low alloy steel products of the forging industry are found at the vital points of almost all modern conveyances and machines. The higher alloys and non-ferrous metals with higher strength to weight ratios and with such properties as resistance to corrosion, high strength at high temperatures, or special reactive, non-magnetic or electrical properties are the ones whose forgings have helped put us into space. Many product designers, however, are not trying to shoot the moon. They are simply shooting for lighter weight, less bulky, stronger, more shock and fatigue resistant, more easily machined and heat treated, and surely more reliable components to match their desires for excellent results.